questions in English, please. So this video is the first video of chapter 3. Chapter 3 is on matter. So we know that chemistry is the study of matter, and matter is everything that surrounds us that you can touch, see, feel, like the food we eat, the drinks, the water, the salts and sugar. And you can see from those pictures, they look like little white cubic crystals. But it's the air we breathe, the plants, the trees, and the dust on Mars. So everything that you can visualize, touch, feel, even ourselves, we are made of matter. DNA here, there's a scanning tunneling microscope, a picture of a piece of DNA. And so we are made of atoms and made of matter. So what is matter? The definition of matter is that it's anything that occupies space, so as a volume, and as a mass, that you can give it a mass. And matter is made up of small particles called atoms. So we've seen that the atoms are the building blocks of matter. And atoms are the basic unit of matter, and they can form elements, molecules, and compounds. So the pictures here you have at the bottom of the slide show you, you know, pictures obtained by either electron microscopy or a scanning tunneling microscope. And you can see, so this is the proof that we, that matter is made of atoms. You can see those spherical shapes which represent single atoms. So you can actually visualize single atoms using those techniques. So on the left, it's single atoms of an element, so the atom seems to be the same. So notice how the colors are just for us to visualize things. It's not real colors. The atoms are not necessarily those colors. So in the center, the picture here is representing a DNA, and so you can see some kind of helixes, and it's made of spherical objects, right? And the picture to the right maybe could represent a compound or a molecule made of a definite number of atoms, right? So we have the proof that atoms exist and that matter is made of atoms. So matter can be found in three main states, physical states. We call them the states of matter, and that's the solid state, the liquid state, and the gas state. Here, the models are representing water in its three different states. So when it's solid, we call it ice. When it's liquid, we call it water. And when it's gaseous, we call it steam. Notice how it's the same molecule, but in the gas state, it's not bonded together. The molecules are free. In the liquid state, they are more packed together, but a random arrangement. And then in the solid state, there is some arrangement. It seems more rigid. So let's look at let's say that besides those three main states, there is also the plasma. Plasma is a state of matter similar to a gas in which some of the particles are ionized. So you can visualize it as an ionized gas. So plasma, like a gas, then will be a state of matter that does not have a definite shape or volume. A gas flows, you can compress it, expand it, so no definite shape or volume. The particles that make up plasmas have electrical charges, right? Because they are ionized, which means they have electrical charges. And so plasma can conduct electricity because electricity is conducted whenever you can move electric charges. Plasma are by far the most common phase of matter in the universe, both by mass and by volume, because plasma is found in stars and on Earth. Here we observe it as charged air produced by lightning. We also can make plasma, so it can be artificially made. For example, the plasma displays in televisions are man-made. But let's go through some solids that you encounter sometimes, maybe. Dry ice is a solid carbon dioxide. You can see from the model that it's made of carbon dioxide molecule, made of one carbon surrounded by two oxygen. That's one molecule. And then there is many of those molecules packed together in a regular arrangement here. If you find a piece of iron in the ground, pure iron, it may look like this. And if we imagine how atoms of iron are put together, they would look like a very strong lattice, where atoms are, packed together in a regular arrangement here. Quartz is also a solid you find on the ground with granite. It's made of silicon oxide. And so the blue might be the oxygen, the red the silicon atoms, or reverse. Actually, the blue must be the silicon, the red the oxygen. And so it's, forming a network like that. And so these are solids you may find in everyday life around you. So there are two types of solids. We can classify them as crystalline solids or amorphous solids. And the difference is in the arrangement. In the crystalline solids, the atoms are arranged in geometric shapes with a repeating order. And in the amorphous solid, there is a random arrangement of the atoms, so no repeating units. You can see that it's not ordered anymore. Atoms are packed in both cases, but there is no order in the amorphous solid versus the crystalline solid. So let's look at examples of crystalline solids. Diamond, made of carbon atoms only, is a crystalline solid, as well as graphite, which is also made of carbon atoms only. But the way atoms are arranged is very different, and this translates into very different properties as well. You know that diamond is a very hard crystal. It's what we call a network crystal. The carbon atoms are strongly bonded to each other, and for each carbon atom, it's surrounded by three other carbon atoms, and or actually four. So each carbon is bonded to four others, and so it forms this structure, and you keep building up on the carbon, and it makes a big giant structure. It's very hard because they are bonded very strongly together, and it's very dense. Graphite is also made of carbon atoms only, but the carbon atoms are forming cycles of six carbons, and those cycles are, the sides of one forms the side of another, and so they're forming layers of cycles of six carbons in an hexagonal shape, but only in layers, as you can see. So there's no bond between layers, there's only bonds within a layer. And so that's why the structure of, or the properties of graphite are very different from the diamond, right? Graphite is brittle, it's black, it's an insulator, but both are considered crystalline solids. Otherwise, crystalline solids are made of ionic compound also. Like sodium chloride is a typical example of a crystalline solid made of ionic compound. The sodium is the purple sphere, and the green spheres are the chlorides. And you can see for each sodium, you have a chloride, and so they are packed together in a cubic lattice. And that translates into the shape of the crystals. You can see that they have a cubic shape. So now these are examples of amorphous solids, which are not ordered. There is no pattern in the way the atoms are arranged. And the most common type of amorphous solids are rubber, so natural rubber. And rubber is found like in rubber bands or tires. And you can see from the model here that it looks like a spaghetti almost, right? It's long chains that are not in having any order, you know, put together. And there is some places where they seem to be bonded and linked together so that it, you know, is solid. But there is definitely no order there. All polymers are amorphous solids. Polymers are made of monomers bonded together into very long chains. And here the model represents polycarbonate, which is the plastic found in CDs and DVDs. And that's just a piece of it, right? So you can see a big blob of atoms tightly bonded together, but there is no order. And glass is also an amorphous solid. So glass, if you would let it cool down very slowly, you would allow it to form crystals. And it would be a crystalline solid. But what we do to get glass is that we don't allow it to cool slowly. We cool it very quickly. And because of that, the atoms do not have time to reorder and make a crystal. They cannot rearrange themselves into patterns. And so that's why you obtain a glass. You can see that there is no order, specific number of cycles of silicon and oxygen in this case. So liquids, you experience liquids in your everyday life. Liquids are very different properties. You can see that all these examples show liquids that are poured. So compared to solids, you can pour a liquid. It flows, it fills the container you're putting it in, like water, ice, and mercury, which is the only metal that is liquid at room temperature. And you can see from the mercury model and water model that molecules are molecules in the case of water are packed together, but pattern, no arrangement. It's a random arrangement. In the case of mercury, it shows how it's only atoms of mercury. For all metals, pure metals, it's, you know, made of just atoms of that metal. And here just mercury atoms. And type freeze is C2H6O2, the formula, carbon, hydrogen, and oxygen in that particular molecule. So gases, you experience gases too, like all those fluorescent light, which are made of so to get the light, you ionize the gas or excite the gas and it emits light. So this example shows argon emitting a purple light. You know about helium. Helium is used to fill balloons. And here the balloons are really big and there is a lot of them all bundled up together. And helium is a very light, very small atom, so very light gas very small density, so it will move up into the air because it's less dense than air. And that's why a person here is able to be lifted by this bunch of balloons filled with helium. Hydrogen was the gas that filled the tank of the Hindenburg, aeroplane or aircraft. And as you know, hydrogen, so it's a potential for energy, right? It's providing a lot of energy, as you can see from this big fire. There's a lot of energy released from hydrogen, so it would be a good, fuel. Unfortunately, it's flammable and so very dangerous. As you can see here, a spark or anything that will trigger the flammability of hydrogen can trigger, you know, its burning. And then it's a catastrophe. So let's watch this video of the properties of liquids and solids and gases.
The states of matter are gas, liquid, and solid. Gases assume the shape and volume of their container. Particles of a gas are separated from each other, move in straight lines, and in a completely random manner. They change direction only when they collide with each other or the container. Liquids have a definite volume and assume the shape of their containers. The particles of a liquid are closely spaced, and so their motion is still random but much more limited. The particles slip past and collide with near neighbors. Solids have a definite shape and volume. Particles of solids are in fixed positions and collide only with near neighbors.